Hello friends, this is Dr. Vishal. Welcome back to Clinical Ortho Series from Team MSD. And today in our topic, we will be discussing about osteomyelitis, which is an important case for the undergraduate UG final year exam. So today, we will be discussing about the nomenclature, the pathogenesis in detail, the clinical features, and what are the various MCQs based on the osteomyelitis, and we will move on to the treatment. So to start with, before going to osteomyelitis, we will discuss something about the bone anatomy and the blood supply. So this is the bone at tibia. So to classify the bone is anatomically divided into three parts: epiphysis, metaphysis, and the diaphysis. So how to remember it easily? So the ends of the bone are called as epiphysis. Remember E, end, epiphysis E. So double E, end, epiphysis. And the center of the bone is called as the diaphysis. Center C, next comes D, so diaphysis. So the part between the diaphysis and the epiphysis is called as the metaphysis. So this is the anatomy. Then coming to the blood supply, you should know about two things. The outer one-third of the bone is supplied by the periosteum, and the middle two-third, the inner two-third, is supplied by the medullary arteries. These are the two things we should know before moving on to the topic of osteomyelitis. So to start with the nomenclature, Nelaton in the year 1834 coined the term osteomyelitis. So what is osteomyelitis? The word osteon means a bone cell. Myelo means marrow, and itis, as we all know, it is inflammation. So whenever a definition is asked, it should be said as the infection and inflammation of the bone and the bone marrow cavity by the microorganisms. Many of us fail to explain the term bone marrow. So that should also be included in osteomyelitis. So what are the various predisposing factors? To start with, the age of the patient. The more the less age and the more the elderly age, they are more prone for immunocompromised individuals. Then comes the trauma. When there is trauma, there will be injury and there will be exposure of foreign bodies to the bone. Then comes the summer season, where there will be more of trauma events taking place. Then comes the causative organisms. Of all the organisms, the pyogenic organism is the most common, and of all the pyogenic organisms, we can say Staph aureus is the most common infecting organism in osteomyelitis. Then according to the scenario, if it is asked as a human bite, then Echinella. Then if it is asked as an animal bite, then it's Pasteurella. Then in case of IV drug abuse, it's Pseudomonas. Then coming to the granulomatous organisms, Mycobacterium tuberculosis and syphilis will cause osteomyelitis. So why this Staph aureus is the most common organism affecting the bones? So to start with, it is the most common skin commensal present in our body. And also, normally the bone is an inner structure which does not provide an environment for the bacteria to get lodged. But this Staphylococcus aureus somewhat find a way, and it has an adhesin receptor which sticks to the bone. So once it is sticking to the bone, it secretes a biofilm which protects the bacteria from the antibiotics. So it keeps on residing in our bone and it keeps on destroying the bone. So this is why Staph aureus is the most common organism to cause osteomyelitis. Then osteomyelitis is classified according to two types. One is based on the duration, as you all know. Just know the classification name is Val Vogel classification. If it is less than 2 weeks, it's acute. If it's 2 to 4 weeks, it's subacute. And if it's more than 4 weeks, it's chronic osteomyelitis. Then comes the Czerny-Mada classification. Just know the name. It is for osteomyelitis. And you should remember one thing in the physiological host status. Just remember type C, the treatment is worse than the disease itself. So you should never treat that condition. Then moving on to the mode of spread. So it spreads by three types. One is the hematogenous due to the infective foci, and second one is the direct inoculation of bacteria like trauma events occurring there, and third one is spread from contiguity, which means the spread is taking place from adjacent joints. So the most common spread occurring in every individual in case of an osteomyelitis is hematogenous spread. So how this occurs? Consider a foci is somewhere present, like an appendix or in a tonsil. The bacteria keeps on circulating in the blood. So for a namesake, just remember the bacteria size is 10 cm. The vessel size is more than 10 cm. The bacteria easily floats in the vessel. When the vessel size is narrow or the lumen is very short, that means if it is less than the bacteria size, then the bacteria will go and encaustic. So that vessel is called as the nutrient artery. So the nutrient artery supplies the inner two-thirds of the bone. Then in the nutrient artery, there are two types of bones. One is the axial bones, which is the spine, and next one is the appendicular bones, which is the lower limb and the upper limb. So this appendicular is affected more in case of osteomyelitis, while in TB, the axial bone is involved. In the appendicular, which bone is most commonly involved, to be said, is the metaphysis of the distal femur, which is involved more than the proximal tibia. Then coming to the metaphysis, why metaphysis is most commonly involved in osteomyelitis? There are various reasons. The most important one are the U-pin bends, where the artery will get anastomosed to the veins. So there will obviously be a stasis of blood supply. Also, there is no endothelial lining in that layer. So any bacteria, if present, will directly go to the bone. And also, there will be no phagocytosis or reduced phagocytosis. So there is no protective role. And the fourth reason, the metaphyseal region is vast blood supply. So more blood supply, more chance for the invading organism to enter the body. So consider this U-pin bend as your metaphysis. So this is your artery and this is your vein. Like this U-turn, consider this as a barrier. Barricade, there is no barricade. So this artery will have to slow down once it crosses here, the blood supply. When the blood is flowing slowly, this microorganism, since it has no barrier, will just move to the bone. So there is no phagocytosis, there is no barrier. This is explained in the next pic, where you can see in the inner diagram, the artery makes a new bend with the venules. So this is why metaphysis is the most commonly affected region. Then coming to the pathogenesis, as I already told, the bacteria will engorge in the nutrient artery, which diameter is actually less than the bacteria. So it just goes and occludes it, and being an end artery, it causes obstruction and further ischemia. Another mechanism is these bacteria, this Staphylococcus aureus, will secrete proteolytic enzymes. So that will cause destruction of the bone. The first step in a response to destruction is the inflammatory mediators. So there will be more inflammation, there will be more destruction, and there will be more edema. This edema will further compromise the blood supply, and the vicious cycle will keep on continuing until the organism is removed. So the end result is ischemia to the bone. Then there are four stages of osteomyelitis. Stage 1 is the cellulitis, where there will be no bony destruction. And stage 2 is the form of exudate formation, which is nothing but pus. Stage 3 is how the pus is escaping out of the bone and finding its various ways. And stage 4 is the stage of healing. So coming to the exudate spread, just see this yellow color pus. It has three ways to spread. It can go, consider if this is the pus region, it can go above, it can go below, or it can move sideways. So it can move above only when the physeal plate is not there. So in that case, if the infant's age or children age is less than 2 years, there will be no physeal plate, so there will be no barrier. This pus will just evade into the epiphysis, which also involves a joint. In case of an adolescent, it spreads downwards into the diaphysis. But most commonly, this pus escape along the route of least resistance, which is sideways. In the medullary canal, there is a pathway. Just remember, there is a tunnel to the cortex, which is called as the Hevesian canals. So the pus from the medulla enters the Hevesian canal, it just moves into the cortex. The next structure that is next to the cortex is the periosteum. So what happens is the periosteum is an elastic structure. When pus seeps out of the periosteum, it just tries to cover it within the periosteum. It tries as much as to prevent the seal off, to prevent the break off periosteum. So when the periosteum is lifting up, the periosteum tries to seal the pus within the bone. So what happens is, as the periosteum is elevated more and more, the cortical blood supply is diminished. As I already told, the outer one third is supplied by the periosteum. So this part, which is devascularized, is called as a sequester. And also, in act of a protective measure, the periosteum keeps on secreting new bone. The cambium layer keeps on secreting new bone, and that new bone is called as involucrum. So to just know, the sequestrum is the pathological hallmark of osteomyelitis, and immunogram is the newborn formation to protect the pus involving. And once it evades the periosteum, the next structure is the soft tissue. There will be soft tissue swelling, and next to the soft tissue will be the skin. So it finds a way from the bone to the skin, and the skin, it presents as a sinus, which is nothing but an opening. So this is the spread of texturates, the various methods, and the most common spread is via the Havasian canal, since it is the least path of resistance. Then comes the photo. We can see here the sinus. So whenever a sinus is present, you know it's because of chronic osteomyelitis. It has pierced the various structures. Then there occurs a predilection for joint involvement. Whenever the metaphysis is involved within the capsule, what happens is the capsule just tries to accommodate the metaphysis. So the metaphysis, the pus will evade into the epiphysis and also into the joints. So the four exceptions here are the hip joint, the ankle joint, the radiocapitellar joint, and the shoulder joint. Next, coming to the clinical features. Just remember the dictum: whenever a febrile child is presenting with inability to move the limbs, unless otherwise ruled out, it's going to be an osteomyelitis. So the various clinical features present are in acute osteomyelitis, there will be both systemic and local features. In subacute, only local. In chronic, there will be presentation like sinus or ulcers. So the patient presents with fever, pain, tenderness, inability to move the limb. So the six signs you are going to elicit are the rubor, there will be redness due to increased blood supply vasodilatation, and there will be dullard pain, there will be calloused warmth, and there will be tumor which is swelling, and most commonly there will be functional asia, which means there is loss of function of the affected limb. So then coming to the laboratory findings, as we all know, whenever there is a fever, the WBC count will be elevated. And the elevated ESR and CRP. ESR is for chronic inflammation, while CRP is for acute inflammation. And the most sensitive and specific marker for osteomyelitis is serum procalcitonin levels more than 0.4 nanogram per ml. So this is an important MCQ. Please take a note. And coming to the blood cultures, it can be positive only in about half the cases. And ultrasound guided aspiration can also be done, but that is least sensitive, and only 30% of that cases will be positive. Then coming to the radiological findings, whenever a baby comes to you with osteomyelitis, you go for an x-ray. You don't find anything because a bony change occurs only after 2 weeks of the infection. So why you take an x-ray? Whenever there is an infection inflammation, there will be soft tissue swelling. So to look for the soft tissue, we take an x-ray. So the early x-ray finding is a soft tissue swelling. For the first bony change to occur, which occurs about 10 to 14 days after the onset of infection, the periosteal elevation occurs. So in the x-ray we can see there is a soft tissue swelling, which indicates there is some inflammation going on. This is the first radiological sign, and the first bony sign in the x-ray is the periosteal elevation, which indicates there is an infection. So then comes your MRI. You can't wait 10 to 14 days to find out whether there is osteomyelitis or not. So the gold standard investigation, what we have to do on the first day of osteomyelitis is MRI. In the MRI, T2 weight image shows fluid or water, which indicates there is bone marrow edema. So this MRI can detect osteomyelitis even in less than 24 hours, and this is the earliest scan to be taken. Then comes to three-phase bone scan, which is just known for MCQ purposes. In all the three phases, the osteomyelitis will be involved, and all the three phases there will be increased uptake. But for osteomyelitis, the most specific phase is the third phase, where the osteoblastic activity will be involved. Then coming to the treatment, just remember it has a mnemonic price. First, they are presenting with pain, so give some painkillers, NSAIDs, then give rest to the limb, then immobilize it, then give cold packs, and give elevation. Whenever you give elevation, there will be no venous congestion and there will be good drainage. Broad spectrum antibiotics should be started at the time of presentation without waiting for any blood culture or sensitivity reports. Only after starting the antibiotic, we start on empirical antibiotics, and only after the result comes, we just move on to the sensitivity reports. Then First, initially, IV antibiotics should be given for a minimum of 5 to 7 days. Then, it should be converted to oral antibiotics if the patient is progressing, and it should be given for a period of 4 to 6 weeks. So, why this 4 to 6 weeks? For a bone to revascularize, minimum of 6 weeks is essential, and that's why we are giving the antibiotics for 6 weeks. Then, surgery. What are the various indications? You are starting the patient on IV antibiotic. If the patient does not involve or if the patient does not progress even after 48 hours, then that is an indication for surgery. And also, whenever there is an evidence of pus collection, the surgery should be attempted. So what we have to do, we just have to incise it. The periosteum should be drilled in a rectangular fashion so the pus will seep out. Then you should keep the drain and close the wound. Once you treat the acute osteomyelitis, it goes three ways. It can be completely cured, or it can be partially cured, or it can be never cured at all. When there is completely cure, we are happy. But when there is a partial resolution, that leads to subacute osteomyelitis. So the most important things we should remember in subacute are the Barr's puffy tumor, which is a subperiosteal abscess associated with the frontal bone. This can be asked as an MCQ. Then coming to the Brody's abscess, the most common site is the upper part of tibia, which is an MCQ. And what happens here is our body is more protective than the virulence. It's more powerful. So what happens is it just tries to protect the pus from preventing it reaching the outer surface. In the X-ray, we can see a lytic lesion surrounded by the sclerotic lesion. So the pus is contained within the bone. That is called a Brody's abscess. Then comes a Garry's sclerosing osteomyelitis, which occurs, unlike metaphysis, this occurs in a diaphysis. So the most common differential diagnosis we should rule out is the Ewing sarcoma. It presents similar to it, but Ewing sarcoma is a tumor which you can do the EWNG. Then comes the chronic osteomyelitis. As we have already seen, sinus and ulcers are the clinical hallmark of chronic osteomyelitis. So what we should do, we should go to the bone, saucerize it. Since bone is a non-giving structure, you can see it's like a cup. When this is like a cup, this pus will keep on just secreting inside the bone. It will not come out. Once it is converted into a saucer-like shape, it is just coming out easily. Then you should do curettage until there are blood paprika signs. So what is paprika saying? You just cure the bone until you find there are new blood vessels. So that means the dead bone is removed and the pus is also let out. Then you always remove a sequestrum, which is a dead bone and which is a source of infection and microorganisms. Then coming out, you remove the sinus tract. This sinus tract excision is also a very important procedure, and these are the four treatments usually done in case of chronic osteomyelitis. I hope this class was useful to you. Thank you.